Over many years in the dialogue world, one of the things we find when we have different religions together is that we learn to respect one another's rituals. So some of the rituals we share in common, we break bread and say a prayer. We say a prayer after the meal. Many of us pray repeated times during the day. But one of the new rituals that has been developed in the interreligious community is one that I invite all of you to take part in as well. Please turn off your cell phones. See, it's off. I'm Bert Vysotsky. I'm the director of the Milstein Center for Interreligious Dialogue here at the Jewish Theological Seminary. And we are just thrilled to have all of you here. And to set the evening in motion, I call upon the chair of the board of the Jewish Theological Seminary, my friend Abby Joseph Cohen.
Good evening, everyone. I am truly delighted to welcome all of you here this evening for a very special event. Tonight, we are honored to host the annual John Paul II Lecture for Interreligious Understanding. This is a collaboration between the Milstein Center for Interreligious Dialogue at the Jewish Theological Seminary and the John Paul II Center for Interreligious Dialogue at the Angelicum in Rome, with special thanks to the Russell Berrie Foundation. The lecture will be delivered tonight by New York Archbishop Timothy Cardinal Dolan on 50 years of Nostra Aetate. And let me thank some special people in this room. On behalf of the Milstein family, I'm delighted to call your attention to Howard and Abby Milstein, who are with us this evening. And also, please. And a very warm welcome and special thanks to Angelica Berrie as well. His Eminence, Archbishop Timothy Cardinal Dolan, is returning to JTS to celebrate Jewish-Catholic relations on the 50th anniversary of the Second Vatican Council. Cardinal Dolan has been Archbishop of New York for 6 years and served as president of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops for 3 years. He is currently a member of the Pontifical Council for Promoting New Evangelization, the Pontifical Council for Social Communications, and the Board of Trustees of the Catholic University of America. He is also the former, chairman of Catholic Relief Services. We are, of course, truly delighted to welcome him back to JTS. Following His Eminence's address, JTS Chancellor Arnold Eisen will offer a brief reply. Arne Eisen, one of the world's foremost authorities on American Judaism, is the seventh chancellor of the Jewish Theological Seminary, which was founded in the 19th century. Since taking office in 2007, Chancellor Eisen has instituted significant changes in the education of leaders for conservative Judaism and for the Religious Center of North American Jewry. This transformation in the training of religious, pedagogical, professional, and lay leaders is having an important impact and has dramatically enhanced the reputation and global reach of JTS. So Arne, thank you for that. A question and answer session will follow the two formal presentations. We are most fortunate this evening to have Laurie Goodstein here to moderate the session. Ms. Goodstein is the national religion correspondent for the New York Times. She joined the Times in 1997, and before that worked for the Washington Post, both in New York City and Washington, D.C. Ms. Goodstein received the first place news reporting award from the American Academy of Religion and has been nominated twice for a Pulitzer Prize. Members of the audience have received index cards to write down questions. These will be collected from you following Chancellor Eisen's reply to Cardinal Dolan and will be collated from Ms. Goodstein. She will direct your questions to both of the speakers. And now it is my distinct honor and pleasure to welcome His Eminence Cardinal Dolan to the microphone of the Jewish Theological Seminary.
Abby, Rabbi Vistowski and Chancellor Eisen, friends one and all, I noticed in the press release for this beautiful evening that I was given the title Ben Bayet. Did I say that properly?
Ben Bayet.
Ben Bayet. And I gladly accept the title, grateful to be considered, what I hear the definition of that term to be, a regular member of the household of the Jewish Theological Seminary. And it's true, everybody. I've been coming here for nearly 15 years, mostly for meetings of the National Jewish Catholic Dialogue, on which I am honored to sit and which I'm now honored to co-chair. And as you might imagine, I felt particularly home here during my half dozen happy years as Archbishop of New York, being in the company of so many of you and enjoying the hospitality here at JTS. I have to admit a little apprehension, as grateful as I am to be a member of the household here at Jewish Theological Seminary. I'll probably, I admit, get a pledge card to contribute to your annual appeal. That's the way we would work anyway, all right? To deliver the John Paul II lecture here, sponsored by the Milstein Center for Interreligious Dialogue of the Jewish Theological Seminary, is a very high honor, everybody, and it is good to be with you, and I thank you very, very much. As has been noted, our gathering this evening is particularly providential as we celebrate the golden jubilee of that inspired document of the Second Vatican Council, Nostra Aetate, a teaching that so dramatically transformed Jewish-Catholic relations. We Catholics sometimes quip that our Jewish neighbors pay more attention to Vatican statements than we do, but both of us have paid attention to Nostra Aetate, thank God. And because of that, the friendship between us, I feel, has never been stronger. Now, how to approach this? How best to address the topic given me for homework, namely a bit of a survey of the 50 years, the half century since Nostra Aetate? Well, the pontiff for over 50% of the half century since that inspired document was Pope, now Saint, John Paul II, for whom this lecture is named and for whom the worldwide Jewish community has a deep reverence. So I thought it might be good to take a look at his contribution to the implementation of Nostra Aetate for a better understanding among all of us as we celebrate this golden jubilee. Just as a little example about the reverence that the Jewish community has for John Paul II, 4 months after his death in 2005, I traveled with four other bishops and about a half dozen rabbis on a very moving trip to Poland and Rome. And when we were in the Eternal City, no surprise, we were running late. And our guide announced that because we were at risk of being tardy for our appointment at the synagogue in Rome, we would have to skip our time of prayer at the tomb of John Paul II. The hell we are, and that's a direct quote, protested the six rabbis. And to stand before his tomb in St. Peter's Basilica, bishops and rabbis' hands joined together, was a pinnacle of our blessed time together. So, taking my cue from the title of this blessed series, the John Paul II Lecture, I propose to speak on Pope St. John Paul II, the dream of Nostra Aetate becomes a reality. Now, I admit that even that topic gives us a lot of latitude. What immediately comes to mind, I think, would probably be two things. One would be the theological advances in Jewish Catholic understanding under John Paul II. And two would be the candid dialogue over the neuralgic issues that arose during his 26-year pontificate. This prestigious center of Jewish theology would be well aware of John Paul II's proposition that we Jews and Christians might now return to the conversation so rudely interrupted in 70 AD when Roman soldiers leveled Jerusalem, scattering both Jews and Christians in a diaspora still with us, and would take up again such profound questions, theological questions, as covenant, election, Israel's special and unique place in God's revelation, the law, and how the two of us are to relate as children of Abraham and people of the book. The acceptance of that invitation from John Paul has resulted in what I think we'd all agree in a promising flourishing of Jewish Catholic scholarship. Likewise, are we cognizant of the radioactive issues the Polish Pope never dodged. Tender topics, remember, such as the Good Friday prayers, the somber and tragic legacy of Christian anti-Semitism, the role of the Holy See during the Shoah, Vatican diplomatic recognition of the State of Israel, or even flashy episodes like the proposed cross and convent at Auschwitz, the usual every 10-year controversy over the Oberammergau Passion Play, Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of the Christ, and the visit of Kurt Waldheim to Rome. Remember all of those? Well, so my point is, I could talk about those two topics, all right? I could talk about the theological issues that were fostered under John Paul II, or the way he met straight on those controversies that I just mentioned. But instead of elaborating on those two admittedly worthwhile issues, I dare suggest, everybody, that Pope John Paul II realized the dream of Nostra Aetate in a much more substantive and innovative way, namely, by trusting the Jewish community enough to invite them into what was indeed the number one priority of his pontificate, to recover the primacy of the spiritual. To recover the primacy of the spiritual. Simply put, John Paul II believed that the most mortal toxin infecting the human project was the denial of God's sovereignty, even his existence, and that the church's most natural ally in facing this challenge were the Jews. Humanity's preference of late to get along just fine without God, to use Rabbi Jonathan Sachs's definition of secularism, was deadly and must be reversed. And the Pope believed that the Jewish community would share indeed in his sense of urgency. Let me try to explain. John Paul II took literally the dictum of your psalmist that only in God is my soul at rest. And that, as your scriptures reveal unremittingly, any attempt to seek absolute peace, meaning, or purpose in anyone or anything else besides God was a recipe for chaos and frustration. It was Billy Graham who had observed that the revival of humanity's empty and exhausted soul became John Paul II's mission. And this pontiff was convinced that our elder brothers and sisters, as he called you, were our most valued partners in this sacred endeavor. He came upon this drive to recover the primacy of the spiritual in the human enterprise quite naturally. The high-octane Catholicism of his beloved Poland saw God's design and presence everywhere. Poland's own tragic history taught Carol Joseph Wojtyla that faith alone would never fail. His Poland, recall, had literally been erased from the maps in the late 19th century, and while its status may have been restored after the horrors of the First World War, it was still left in the dirt. So young Carol Wojtyla turned to your Psalms. Whoever trusts in God is like Mount Zion, unshakable. It stands forever. He himself had lost everything. His mother, his sister, his brother, who was a distinguished physician who succumbed to an epidemic while treating those suffering from it, and his beloved father by the time he was in his early 20s. With the rest of Poland, he relates how he cried on September 1st, 1939, as he watched the Luftwaffe swarm over his country, and then lived in daily danger for six bleak years, watching Jewish friends and his own classmates in the secret seminary in Krakow disappear nightly. Early one morning, coming home from work in the chemical factory, he was hit by a truckload of Nazi soldiers and left for dead on the side of the road. And as you know, things didn't get much better as Poland lost the war twice. When the jackboots of Hitler's thugs were replaced by those of Stalin's, as the climate of enforced, oppressive living without God continued to smother Poland. What got the people of Poland through? The faith expressed by Jewish wisdom, only in God is my soul at rest. Is it any wonder that his first words on the balcony of St. Peter's Basilica on October 16, 1978, were those repeated so often by the God of Israel, "Be not afraid"? Maybe the best illustration of this strategy of John Paul II to recover the primacy of faith came during what has been called those 9 days that changed the world, when he returned to Poland the first 9 days of June 1979. Henry Kissinger would claim that he then did for Poland what Churchill had done for England. Mikhail Gorbachev would later conclude that those days were, quote, the beginning of the end of communist hegemony, a hammer and sickle which had especially been used against Catholics and Jews. On the final day of that historic visit in Victory Square in Warsaw, between 2 million Poles, he began to deliver what all somberly felt would probably be his last public address ever in Poland. He had only spoken for a few moments when a three-word chant began. It started in a corner of the vast assembly, but soon tsunamied over the throng as 2 million Poles shouted at the top of their voice those same three words. What were those three words? Were they down with communism? Nope. Were they Russia go home? Nope. The three words were, we want God. We want God. That chant went on for 2 minutes, for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes. We want God. His nervous attendant, Monsignor Virgilio Noe, whispered to him, Holy Father, perhaps you might want to hush the crowd so you can finish your sermon, only to have John Paul smile at him and quietly observe, are you nuts? This is why I came. We want God. We want God. The primitive cry of faith, of belief, of humanity's innate longing for the divine, a thirst denied and ignored and ridiculed and outlawed and reasoned away for too long by the lies of a society and a culture that had vainly sought purpose in systems and mentalities that forgot God. It was as if John Paul's visit to his beloved homeland had put on the lips of his people the pining of the Hebrew psalmist, like a deer that thirsts for living water, so my soul longs for you, O my God. We want God. That, of course, is the quintessential cry of Israel. And John Paul II saw today's children of Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Moses, David, and the prophets as essential to the recovery of the primacy of the divine in a world drugged to forget its Lord. John Henry Newman had worried a century before that shout in Victory Square in Warsaw that we now have, quote, an experience of a world that is simply irreligious. The leading peritus expert on John Paul II, George Weigel, will tell us that the Pope looked right into the eyes, stared right into the eyes of this deformation of the great humanistic project in which the God of the Hebrew and Christian Bible came to be regarded as the enemy of human maturation and liberation, and he didn't blink, observes Weigel. In the pervasive worldview of atheistic humanism created by such thinkers as Comte, Feuerbach, Marx, and Nietzsche, biblical religion was the enemy, for it impeded the progress of humanity. Thus, moderns must free themselves from the constraints of faith, that it might march boldly into a bright, humane future, freed from those shackles imposed on it by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. No wonder Solzhenitsyn could conclude that the horrors of World War I and II could have happened only because man had forgotten God. John Paul II's cause then was to rally Catholics, Christians, and Jews to shout out, "We want God!" For what had been squandered was a sense of awe at the very mystery of God, a mystery at the soul of Judaism and Christianity. Our visions have been blotted. Skepticism and cynicism dominate our discourse. All seems at the mercy of manipulation by stubborn self-willfulness, and the pleasure principle has ended up robbing us of joy. Man had become a puzzle for technicians to solve, not a mystery for poets to love and embrace. Nostra Aetate tells us that all of us comprise a single community and have a single origin. One also is our final goal, namely union with God. His providence, his goodness, his saving designs extend to all against the day when we'll be united in that holy city ablaze with the radiance of God, where all the nations will walk in his light. A couple months ago, I was honored to host the chief rabbi of Rome, Riccardo Di Segni, for lunch. He confided in me at that time, confided, now it's public, the intentions of Pope Francis soon to visit the synagogue in Rome. And he also recalled the visit of John Paul to that synagogue in 1986, when the Pope called Jews and Christians to, quote, a collaboration in favor of humanity. For Jews and Christians, our belief in God has certain implications, which John Paul believed impel Jews and Christians to work together. One would be our insistence on the dignity of the human person, created, according to Genesis, in God's own image and likeness, made, so says your psalmist, little less than a god. Two would be the sanctity of every human life. Never, life that is, never a means to an end, but an end in itself to be cherished and protected. Three would be an allegiance to God's law. Truths, as John Paul commented at Mount Sinai, written on the human heart before engraved in stone, not to be contradicted by self-will or popular demand. Four would be the word that he made common at the kitchen tables of the world, solidarity, a sense that we're all in this together and that we're much better off sticking together and looking out for each other than we are locked up in our own petty comforts. And fifth would be a mutual worldview. You see, Jews and Catholics, John Paul believed, share the same glasses, the same spectacles. Simply put, we believe history is his story. The history of salvation in which Jews and Christians believe is, in fact, the history of the world and our own personal history. Both John Paul II and Rabbi Joshua Herschel would remind us that coincidence is only the term that non-believers use instead of providence. And like Heschel, John Paul II was convinced that the human story is not so much the recounting of our search for God, but of God's search for us. So, Pope John Paul II could become a pilgrim like Abraham, reminding the world of its real story, its genuine identity, its God's creation unfolding according to his plan, the story of Abraham, Moses, David, and Jesus. This optic, common to both Jews and Christians, makes us, as John Paul II often commented, a blessing to one another. Together, we share our eyeglasses with others, so all can see that history is indeed his story, that human dignity and life is enhanced, not shackled, when we proclaim we want God, that each of us is called to renew the Exodus, allowing the Lord to free us from slavery and death, to freedom and life, as we celebrate each spring at Passover and Easter. It was Theodor Herzl, a century ago, who understood that anti-Semitism is proof that something is seriously flawed in the culture of the West. Listen again to George Weigel. When the fever chant of anti-Semitism spikes upward, it's always the sign that the patient is in mortal danger, in no small part because it has forgotten the biblical roots of the Western civilizational enterprise. For the foundational Western metaphor of freedom and human liberation is not the Enlightenment, but the Exodus. And the Exodus is a liberation completed by a moral code intended to help the free rid themselves of the habits of slaves, the bad habits that derive from willfulness and self-absorption. Ileo Toaf, who was chief rabbi of Rome when John Paul visited the synagogue on the Tiber River, died just a couple weeks ago. You knew that, right? Pope John Paul II, did you know this? Pope John Paul II mentioned only two men in his brief last will and testament. He thanked first his loyal priest secretary, Stanislaw Jivich, and he thanked Ileo Toaf. No wonder. Carol Wojtyla and Ileo Toaf, a Catholic and a Jew, were two men who sensed the agonizing groans of their century deep in their guts, and who believed that only by placing God first and entrusting and respecting one another can we ever get back on the path to God instead of on a dead-end road of forgetting or denying him. Those theological questions of election, covenant, revelation, messianic hope, divine promise, and redemption, scholarly questions Jews and Christians now both proudly probe together, those social and cultural challenges we face, such as ominous anti-Semitism and the persecution of Christians, all start with our mutual chant, so innate in the very fiber of Jews and Christians, that we want God. We need God. Dominant cultural attempts to sideline him, reject him, deny him, ignore him, run from him, or mock him only lead to trouble. So that's my plug, folks, that Nostra Aetate inspired John Paul II not just to tolerate Jews, not just to have theological discussions with them, however valuable they are, not just to meet with them at times of controversy and neuralgia, as important as that is, but to invite them into a providential and urgent partnership flowing from a mutual faith, love, and biblical roots, where Jews become like their prophets of old and Catholics like the 12 apostles, in calling the world away from the worship of false gods, false idols, into the arms of the one true eternal God who personally and passionately loves us, who has a plan for us, in whom alone we find purpose and peace. When I was a boy in fourth grade, we had to memorize your Ten Commandments. Our eight Beatitudes were easier, by the way. The pastor at the parish, sister told us, would be in the next day to quiz us. I knew those Ten Commandments by heart, or so I thought, until Father Callahan happened to call on me in class to recite them. I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before me. I started out fine, but after that first one I went blank. And was I ever relieved when the pastor said, "Well, Tim, that's the most important one. All the others flow from that one." John Paul II would have agreed. I think Jews would agree. Christians would agree. And Nostra Aetate, 50 years old, just a baby to a Jew or a Christian, would agree. And urge us to work together to teach it to a world which now sadly goes hoarse when urged to shout, "We want God." Thank you.
Thank you, Cardinal Dolan, for again being with us and for that important and subtle, I think quite far-ranging address from which I, for one, learned a lot, and I'm sure I'm not alone in this room. I want to say that your presence here and your words are the latest chapter in a long and fruitful exchange between the Catholic Church and the Jewish community of the city of New York, and they represent another testimony to how seriously JTS has always taken dialogue and partnership with other religious communities and their leaders. This is the raison d'etre of the Milstein Center and the Finkelstein Institute before it, and of the Institute for Religious and Social Studies established by Chancellor Louis Finkelstein way back in 1938. Nostra Aetate, of course, means in our day, in our time. And let's say that in 2015, as much as in 1965, or maybe even more than in 1965, we live in a time when dialogue and partnership among religious groups and religious leaders has assumed new urgency. There are representatives of religion in this world, and I'm sad to say in this country, who believe and proclaim that faith in God requires them to disrespect or oppose or persecute or even kill believers in the same God who practice a different faith. JTS has always taught and practiced exactly the opposite conviction. Nostra Aetate, our time, demands as much as ever, as JTS has always demanded, that religious voices in the service of interreligious respect be as loud and persistent as those that seek to drown out this commitment with bombs or bullets. It's as simple as this, I think, and this is the words that I heard in your talk and in John Paul. If we're silent, they will win. If we are silent, they will win. That is why I'm so grateful to you for being here and for such a rich and probing talk. You summoned us to do work, to do it now, and to do it together, and I think we all agree that the alternative is just too awful to contemplate. So I want to pick up two points in your address, both of which flow directly, as we would expect, not only from Pope John Paul, but from Nostra Aetate itself. I shall call the first point the humility of confidence, or utmost trust that expresses itself in utmost humility. And the second point draws on a recent declaration by Pope Francis that, quote, "The one who doesn't know to dialogue does not obey God." We all know that theology is often very long, often very verbose, often very complicated, and I have about 5 minutes at my disposal. So I'm going to offer you what you might call Jewish theological snippets, or for short, JTS. Here we go. So Cardinal Dolan very eloquently called us to partnership. And sometimes I, as a person of faith, wonder what theological prerequisites have to be in place inside a group or inside a self to make that partnership possible and urgent. One of them is going to be this combination between confidence and humility that I mentioned before. I wondered for a long time, ever since I started reading Abraham Joshua Heschel, where he got the confidence, some would even say the chutzpah, to declare in his book, God in Search of Man, that much of what passes for religion in our day is irrelevant, oppressive, insipid, and dull. Where did he get the confidence to say that? And where did he get the humility to assert as well, as he did in his famous address across the street at Union Theological Seminary in 1965, which is another theological high point of 50 years ago that we're going to be observing this year? Where did he get the confidence to say, the humility to say, no religion is an island? He said there, Jews and Christians need one another to face up to, quote, the challenge and the expectation of the living God. We shouldn't pass over this remark and the humility that it entails. We can't do it ourselves. We need another faith to face up to the challenge and the expectation of the living God. I think one clue to that combination of confidence and humility comes from the metaphor of land and sea, so prominent in Heschel's book, Man is Not Alone. We sail to faith and in faith, he wrote, because our mind is like a fantastic seashell, and when applying our ear to its lips, we hear a perpetual murmur from the waves beyond the shore. A few pages later, Heschel compared faith to an island to which we move across the wake of undying wonder. I take Heschel's metaphor very seriously. One does not need to be a mystic in order to believe that terra firma is not where faith lives. There's too much trust involved in faith for that to be the case. Too little that is certain. Too much doubt. Too many of what Heschel called leaps of action, decisions to do more than we understand in order to understand more than we do. One can't walk across the water to God. That happens in your tradition, but not in mine, and I think it only happened once, if I'm not mistaken. We don't walk on water to God. We swim as best we can, and some of us don't swim very well. We're carried by currents more powerful than we can master or understand. In another teaching in this vein, Heschel declared, quote, we are not God's accountants. We are not God's accountants. If we did know how history works, if we could be sure of the mechanics of getting to God and knowing God, if we could take God's attendance record at key moments in history, or report on God's absence from earthquakes or genocide, if we could figure out why Pope John Paul lost so many that he loved to the Nazis, and why Abraham Joshua Heschel also lost so many that he loved to the Nazis, if we could figure all that out and understand why a child suffers in a hospital bed, we would have less uncertainty. We would probably also have less humility, probably have less need for one another, and therefore less mutual respect. Most of us by a certain age have reason to believe, as Solomon Schechter put it in a phrase that I love, quote, I do know something. I do know something. Not everything, but something. Religious or non-religious, Catholic or Jews, Muslim or Hindu, we are betting our lives on the meaning, on the community, on the truth to be had inside a certain set of teachings and rituals and commandments and books of scripture and, yes, interfaith dialogues. We know what we love almost as clearly as we know whom we love. And yet, as Pope Francis and Cardinal Dolan and Pope John Paul all remind us, we have much to learn. And we can only learn it if we listen well to voices we have not yet really heard. Pope Francis wrote, "The one who does not dialogue wants to silence those who preach the newness of God." I like that, the newness of God. Nostra Aetate dwells on the lessons that Catholics can learn from Hinduism and Buddhism and from Islam before urging respect for Jews and Judaism and denouncing anti-Semitism. Quote, "We cannot truly call on God, the Father of all, if we refuse to treat in a brotherly way any man created as he is in the image of God." Substitute gender-neutral terms in that sentence, and one has a profound truth for our time and any time. Nostra Aetate cites the New Testament to say, "He who does not love does not know God." He who does not love does not know God. Last week in synagogue, we Jews read the Torah portion that contains the verse on which that line is likely based. The portion is entitled Kedoshim, holy, because of its opening injunction to be holy in everything we do, including business dealings, sexual relationships, treatment of the poor, rituals of worship, and performance of priestly responsibilities. And smack in the middle of those diverse commandments are the three Hebrew words that have directed human lives over our two faiths and others too for two millennia, "Ve'ahavta l'orecha kamocha," love your neighbor as yourself. I would suggest it takes utmost confidence to be sure this is God's way for us, given the guns and the bombs that say the opposite. And it takes no less confidence to be sure that the way we want to walk is indeed the way of love. It also takes utmost humility to do that, because you have to join your life to causes and claims for far larger than yourself, broader than your community, deeper even than your own faith. Of all the gifts that Cardinal Dolan shared with us this evening, perhaps the greatest was his sense of the urgency of this task, of not temporizing, of not being afraid, of wanting God, of insisting on partnership. And I think that this lesson of insisting on partnership is one that, if we can somehow follow it a little better in our time, we have much more assurance than we do right now that we'll be able to gather again 50 years from now and celebrate the 100th anniversary of Nostra Aetate in true peace and friendship. Thank you very much.
I want to call New York Times religion reporter Laurie Goodstein to begin moderating the questions and answers. Many of you received index cards, and I know that many of you have already written your questions. We have ushers coming down the aisle. If you need a card, they have cards, they have pencils, you can write down your golf score, whatever you want. But the questions will drive Laurie's Q&A. We took advantage of the fact that we knew the Cardinal was coming here, and some of us also wrote questions that we want to hear the answers to. But just as I call Laurie up, I want to say one word to the Cardinal and to the Chancellor for all of us, and I'll say it very simply. Wow. Thank you.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here and an honor to be asked to field your questions and advance us into the next 50 years. Hearing you, Cardinal Dolan, hearing you talk about St. John Paul II reminded me of a story I haven't thought about in a long time. It's one of the first stories I wrote for the New York Times, and one of the most moving experiences I ever had. and that is to be able to speak with the childhood friend of John Paul II. I might not pronounce his name right. I think it's Jerzy Kluger. They grew up together in Wadowice,
right,
in Poland. And they were very, very close. And Jerzy Kluger was Jewish. You know, actions like what Pope John Paul did, the kind of friendship he had with Jews, the kind of advocate he was, genuine advocate for the Jewish people, didn't come from nowhere. There's dialogue, there's also relationships, and he had a genuine relationship as a boy. So hearing you talk about him made me wonder something. Perhaps it's a personal question, but I'd love to know, for you, you come here from somewhere. Who is, in your life, the first Jewish person you came to know? Do you have a memory of that? Did that person have an imprint on you?
Thanks, Laurie. No. For me, I was raised in what you might call I was raised in maybe a Catholic ghetto, all right? And I really never came to know, and then I was in the seminary. I went into the seminary right after eighth grade when I was 14 and went to college, so somewhat of an enclosed life. When I went to Rome, now, that having been said, I was also raised in a culture and a family that was extraordinarily respectful of everybody, and that was a value. So sometimes we caricature a closed religious environment as breeding a lack of tolerance or maybe a sense of prejudice toward others. Thanks be to God that never, ever would have been the case with my family or even my neighborhood. I can never remember any anti-Semitic or any, for that matter, any racial comments. But Laurie, the first Jewish person that I came to know and respect and feel very comfortable with was probably someone whose name would be familiar to people at this great institution, Joseph Lichten. Would that name ring a bell? Joseph Lichten was a Jewish scholar, not a rabbi, a Jewish scholar who lived in Rome, but he was an American, and who was an observer at the Second Vatican Council, and who had a very strong role in responding to the drafts of Nostra Aetate. Joseph and his wife lived in Rome, and were very close to us, Laurie, when we were seminarians at the North American College. And I, and a lot of my classmates, became very close to him. He was older than we were. He taught us. He taught a mandatory class at the North American College on Judaism that itself was a sign. I got there in 1972 of how important an understanding and appreciation of Judaism would be in the formation of a future priest. And we got to know him extraordinarily well and to love him, really. And I kept in touch with his wife after his death. They've both gone to the Lord now. But I think the implication of your question is that, thank you, in that you, I think the hint is that I obviously feel very comfortable with and have a deep respect for Jewish colleagues and neighbors in the Jewish community. Where does that come from? With you are correct, I think, in that Carol Joseph Vitia, it came from being raised by especially a remarkable father who was a most open and tolerant, a man of vast learning and latitude, and his own Jewish friends. That wouldn't apply to me. So I can only thank Almighty God for whatever sense and appreciation would have been sparked, I think, with Joseph Lichten. Did anybody know him? Would any of the veterans here know of? Yeah, good. Good, in Rome?
Very interesting.
Was that his role? Am I correct in that he was an American?
Thank you.
I thought he was an American citizen, but.
American citizen.
Right.
He was originally, I think he was born in
Okay. All I know is he never missed Thanksgiving dinner at the North American College.
And we first met when you were the rector. Were you the rector at the NAC? Uh-huh. Right, right.
I was from 94 to 2001.
That's right.
Thanks for remembering.
Yeah. I remember very well. No, you hosted a group of journalists.
Ah,
yeah.
Good.
There's a question here, I think, that is very appropriate for today. And I might elaborate on it a little bit. It's how can we tone down religious incitement against the religious other? And I want to kind of narrow that down a little bit, because we find ourselves even just this very week in a big discussion about the boundaries between free speech and hate speech. After the shooting last Sunday, at the event in Texas at what organizers called an art exhibit and contest to draw the Prophet Muhammad. And it's similar to the discussion that came after the terrorists attacked Charlie Hebdo in Paris. In the United States, at least, the First Amendment seems to have taken us to a point where really anything goes. Any kind of insult to faith, to religious people. You can hold a Nazi march in Skokie, you can display a crucifix in a jar. So do you think that this is, you know, the best approach, or should we start talking about drawing some lines? What can we do about really what we are in an era really of incitement and provocation?
That's a hard one. I'm going to let you take that.
You're so deferential. You know, John Paul II used to say that true freedom is not the liberty to do what we want, but the ability to do what we ought. And I think that's very wise for the question that Laurie just posed. And once again, I don't think we're far off track if we look for the answer to that in our mutual biblical roots. Our biblical roots, the wisdom of God's revelation, would teach us both about rights and about responsibilities, and that the two of them are intimately allied. If we stress one without the other, we're in trouble. So there's a balance there, that every right is tethered to a responsibility, and every responsibility grows to protect a right that we have. I would propose to you that's found in our common biblical wisdom. It is also particularly a principle in the United States, which I don't think any of us apologize for the fact can be traced to a biblical wisdom, that our founders also believed that rights and responsibilities must go together. I would presume, Laurie, that the problem that we have now, and I would think John Paul II would agree, and I think that he would put this would be one of the chapter headings in the project to which he called both Catholics and Jews and recovering our spiritual primacy, is that we have to begin to restore that right now we have an exaggerated sense of rights that are not balanced by an appropriate sense of responsibility. Now, Pope Francis has the ability to say things in a much chattier way than John Paul II, and he got in a little trouble until people realized what he had said when he responded to the very question that Laurie just proposed to me, remember, on the airplane, when he said, yes, freedom of speech is a right that we would cherish and protect in another person. That freedom of speech has limits. And he pointed to his press secretary and he said, my friend here has freedom of speech. If he says something insulting about my mother, he has violated the limits, and he might find my hand going towards his nose. Now, coming from the man whom we call the vicar of the Prince of Peace, that was a little, that was a good soundbite, folks. But in his chatty, homespun way, he was talking about what his predecessor once removed would have called the balance between rights and responsibilities. I think it's a discussion we're having in the United States. It's just not limited to religious people. It's a discussion that any civilized society is having and must have.
That's right. And we, on university campuses and elsewhere, we want to draw the limits of free speech as broadly as we can. We don't want to shut down dialogue, but we don't want to allow hate speech either. So we want to make a distinction between speech and hate speech. And every minority, and by this I include Jews and Catholics and Muslims in America, needs the First Amendment. We're here, we're flourishing as religious groups because of the First Amendment, and we can't compromise on the First Amendment. But we also have to recognize that there's no need to go out of your way to insult people. Mm. Right? So we don't want our First Amendment rights harmed, infringed, but are we doing these demonstrations of free speech, in this case the Cartoon Festival, in order to demonstrate free speech? Or are we doing it explicitly to denigrate another faith? And that's a hard one.
There are a number of questions here that I think kind of come into the same category, and they may be along the lines of some of what you referred to as the neuralgic issues that I think we're not going to dwell on, but I think these are good questions and obviously on the minds of more than one person here. And that is that, how do you ensure that the lessons of Nostra Aetate filter down to the pews, to the lay people? Someone asks, what about the catechism? How do you make sure that instructional material in Catholic schools is consistent? Is that an issue, and is that under discussion?
It is an issue. We're talking about accountability here. It's also a bit of a trepidation. Population in general, but in our Catholic population, the majority of our people would not have remembered the era before Nostra Aetate. Those of us in this room can. And an event like this that we so enjoy and take so naturally and take so for granted would have not been possible. Mm-hmm. We older guys sometimes worry, even bishops sometimes worry about our seminarians, whom we admire a lot, and we're not blaming them for it. They would have been raised in a climate where ecumenism and interfaith cooperation was taken for granted, so you don't have to work at it because it's just there, it's going to stay. And we all know the hard way, if it's not something that you constantly work at and constantly remind yourself of, it will quickly dissipate. Now, I hope this doesn't sound jingoistic, but I think this is an obligation particularly incumbent upon Catholics and Jews in the United States, because we live in a laboratory of ecumenical and interfaith amity. We really take it for granted, and we know it works, you see? We know it works. I can remember it was about 10 years ago. Can you remember, Archbishop, Barney, who was before Cardinal Koch in the Jewish Catholic dialogue? Was it? It was Casper, okay. Mm-hmm. When Cardinal Casper came over about 10 years ago, I was at a talk he gave, and he opened up, I was in Milwaukee then, and he opened up the talk, and he couldn't get through it without choking up. When he said, I just came from New Jersey, and I spoke at a Jewish synagogue. And he said, as I was waiting for the talk, I happened to look at the bulletin board. And there was a note up from the rabbi saying, as you have heard, the mosque down the street suffered a fire. So for the next 3 or 4 months, I've invited the Muslims to come here for their Sabbath and to use this as their center for worship. Cardinal Casper could not get through telling that story without choking up, and he said, only in America could that happen. Only in America could that happen. So this friendship, this mutual appreciation and understanding that we take for granted and that Laurie rightly suggests could be at peril if there's not some type of accountability, is especially something that you and I need to remind the world of. And if I can get a little more particular, especially New Yorkers. Absolutely. Especially New Yorkers. Because we've literally got a block by block, building by building, interfaith and ecumenical cooperation going on, right? We live it every day. And we've got something to give to the world. My fear comes, and I'm talking now more from a Catholic point of view, the areas of the world where Catholicism is most growing, thanks be to God, would be Africa and Asia, all right? Alleluia, to borrow one of your words, okay? Most of them have never met a Jew, all right? Most of them are unaware of Jewish community. Now, that could be good, that could be bad. But if you believe, as I think I do, and as if we've all learned, that some type of human interreaction provides a very fertile foundation for spiritual, moral, and religious interaction, then we've got an added challenge. There, we could have a pope from Africa who has never met a Jew, all right? And has come from a country where there is not a Jewish population. Now, I'm not about to jump to the conclusion that means that he's going to be unlettered when it comes to things Jewish. But that is something that I think we Americans take particularly for granted that can't be said throughout the world. So as not Pope John Paul II, but his successor, Pope Benedict, instituted a system of accountability when it would come to what we call, do you use the word catechesis? That's the forming in the faith, the teaching of religion to our children. Catechesis, handing on the faith, the science of passing on the faith, the art. And he asked that there be a system of accountability in looking at textbooks, in looking at catechisms, in making sure that it's part of seminaries and educational institutions, that, well, all the documents of the Second Vatican Council, but he particularly cited Nostra Aetate, that we'd be held accountable to make sure that we are teaching not only in line with doctrinally, but in the spirit of what Nostra Aetate taught. So it's a very real challenge.
Laurie, I'll just add that one of the fascinating findings of a book called American Grace several years ago, a study of American religion by Robert Putnam and his team, was that Americans are overwhelmingly tolerant. Their clergy are far less tolerant. Now, when you think about it, because clergy might have made the decision to be what we call true believers, and they believe that true belief involves exclusion of others with false belief. Whereas the average person who lives aside, has friends, maybe marriage partners, all sorts of people from different faiths, we know from experience that we can get along, and we have to get along, and we get along on earth, and so the vast majority of Americans believe we're going to get along in heaven. The majority of clergymen do not believe we're going to get along in heaven. And this is a striking finding, which is one of the reasons that impels us at JTS to make sure our clergy get a strong background in interfaith understanding. Mm-hmm. We've got to do better than this.
I'll see you in purgatory.
All right.
You know that's the cover of tomorrow's New York Post. You're here, right? It won't be the New York Times. So I have a lot of questions here and came with a lot of questions about Pope Francis, of course. Everybody is anticipating his visit.
No, you can't interview him.
That's part of your job is getting the list of who wants to meet with Pope Francis while he's here. I think people want to know what you think his message is going to be.
Well, and I'm glad Archbishop Alza is here too, because he and I are both kind of the ones responsible for the for his time in New York, which is going to be brief. He would arrive on a Thursday evening, September 24th, and depart very early Saturday morning, September 26th. He will come to us from D.C. He will depart from us to go to Philadelphia, which is the main reason he's coming, for an event called the World Meeting of Families. And his full day here, good half of it's going to be taken up with Archbishop Alza at the United Nations. You know, Laurie, the little bit I have spoken to him about his visit to New York anyway, I find him eager to learn about us. Now, he is, and I tell you this, he's a little nervous about coming, isn't he, Archbishop Alza? Not that he lacks any confidence in the reception of friendship that he knows he'll get, but he's very... He readily admits he has never been to the United States. And he's never been to the United States. The first time I went in, when I was president of the conference to meet with him, he took an atlas out and asked me to kind of graph, you know, go through the different regions and show him where the different cities were. And he's very shy about not knowing English. You know, he knows Italian and Spanish very well. He's bilingual. And I think Archbishop Alza would agree, his English is a little better than he lets on. Mm-hmm. But he's not conversational in English, and that makes him nervous. So you already know, one of his winsome ways is that he's as heartfelt and as loving and warm as he is, he's kind of shy, and he's a little apprehensive about coming because he's never been here before. So I sense that he's very eager to meet us and to see us and to come here and to listen. And I don't think we'll let him down. I think we'll give him an earful and an eyeful, don't you? So, Art, you've invited him here, haven't you? It's one of the first invitations was to come here.
And thank you for putting us on his calendar. We appreciate that very much.
You need to know that he told Archbishop Alza and me the essentials that he wanted when he's here, and one of them is an interreligious meeting, that he so admires what we were just talking about, the climate of concord in the United States among religions, which he believes could be a light to the world in what we're going through, that he wants to have an interreligious meeting, and that will happen. And that's going to be a high point, I think, of his visit here. So,
what might that look like? That's shaping up?
That is shaping up. Father Massa is here, who's one of the priests that I've asked to run that, and I think we kind of work, it's a little bit of a ballet here, because while the people in Rome that plan it do give us some liberty, they kind of set some boundaries. It's that whole rights and responsibilities. So we kind of now are proposing things to them. But what I find refreshing is that the Holy Father insisted that a substantive interreligious meeting be part of his visit. And I'm honored that he chose that to happen in New York. I think that's a good thing. So.
There's no end to the curiosity about Pope Francis.
You have one more question.
One more? Oh, good. Well, this might be a good one to
sure.
end on, if you don't mind if I ask another Pope Francis question.
Not at all.
Is that all right? you were in the room when he was elected.
Mm-hmm.
as it was apparently the Holy Spirit. We were all there together. And, you know, there were some there who said they didn't really know him very well, didn't know what to expect. So I'm wondering what it is about Pope Francis that has surprised you the most.
What has surprised me, Laurie, would be two things. First of all, that he so obviously listened to what his brother cardinals had said in the days before the conclave. You might, if you can think back, everybody knows what the conclave is. That's when you actually are locked into the Sistine Chapel to elect the new successor of Peter. What I would never have known until having gone through that is that almost as important as that is what we call the congregation, which would be the daily meetings of the College of Cardinals leading up to the conclave. Those went on for 2 weeks. At the beginning of those meetings, I was kind of, as a newcomer, I was bristling. Well, when are we going to get to the conclave? Come on, when is that? You know, and the older cardinal said, listen, kid, relax. This is very, very important. This is like the Iowa and the New Hampshire primaries, all right? And you have to get to know your brother cardinals, and that will happen here. And it did. And so what happened is after 10 days of intense prayer and listening to one another, the cardinals spoke very freely and frankly about the challenges they felt the church was facing. And we knew in speaking that we were addressing somewhere the man that would come out, the new successor of St. Peter. And my pleasant surprise is that Pope Francis listened so intently. There would not be a cardinal who would been in those congregations or conclave who would be shocked at any of the decisions or initiatives that Pope Francis have made. You just would sort of nod and say, ah, yeah, I remember that came up. My second surprise would be how charismatic he is. You see, he was known to be a man of deep piety and a man of deep compassion, but a very private, a very shy, a very retiring man. And I can remember Mass when he inaugurated his papacy, standing with a cardinal from South America. And Pope Francis decided, you know, there's, 250,000 people in the square. So before the Mass, he decided to ride through the square to see the people in the Pope Mobile. And we saw him beaming and waving and embracing and smiling. And this Latin American cardinal said to me, who's that? He said, that's not the Jorge Bergoglio that I remember. Now, he said it kind of happily. One of the men that has followed him most closely is John Allen, who, by the way, if you ever want to have it, you would know him, Laurie. Oh, yes. And if you ever want to have a great, he would be a good, he's an American, probably the first American ever to achieve the title of a Vaticanista, a revered authoritative source on the workings of the Vatican. And he has written a book called The Miracle of Francis, an excellent book, on precisely that point, that the man who entered the conclave and the man who left the conclave seemed to be two different people. Now, Francis himself says that he was very apprehensive about accepting, and I can remember sort of him being kind of stooped, and you could barely hear him say, accepto, I do accept. And you could see that he was just sort of nervous and a little bit clumsy. And he himself says how when he left the Sistine Chapel and we all followed him to go to the central loggia for him to greet the people, he stopped at the Pauline Chapel, which we would pass, and he went in to visit the Blessed Sacrament to pray. And he prayed there for about 10 minutes on his knees. And when he stood up, he says he felt a different man. Now, we Jews and we Catholics believe that God never calls us or asks us to do something without giving us the grace to do it, right? And that's what he's saying happened to him. And he's now become a changed man. I sort of liked him before. And I like him better now, because now it's not, before I had admired kind of an internal fortitude, a deep piety, a wonderful theological sophistication, and an extraordinarily compassionate heart, particularly for those on the margins, but kind of quiet and shy. Now we've got that combined with, in a way, a very embracing, warm, gracious personality, and that's a gift to the world.
Amen.
Well, I think you said it well, a gracious, warm, embracing personality. Thank you, Cardinal Dolan. Before I say goodnight, I have gifts. First of all, JTS has gone back into the publishing business, and this year we published with the New City Press, the publisher is here, Jim Wave, so, which is a Catholic press. We jointly published A Dialogue of Life Toward the Encounter of Jews and Christians. It is an English translation of a dialogue book done by a rabbi and a member of the Focolare. Not the Pope, down in Buenos Aires, and we want to give you a copy.
Thank you.
And Laurie, give you a copy.
Thank you.
We also published a work called Sharing the Well, a resource guide for Jewish-Muslim engagement.
Ooh.
I'm very proud to say that some of our Muslim authors were here tonight, some of our Jewish authors were here tonight, and we hope that you will both enjoy this. And last but not least, just published is Conservative Judaism Today and Tomorrow, Essays by Chancellor Arnold Eisen.
Bravo. Thank you.
I hope you will all attend to the poster, the flyer we have outside on June the 1st, a day-long program, and then an evening program on the changing face of the American Jewish family. So you can get the information as you leave. Thank you and good night.
Uh-huh.
You know, sometimes I make the mistake of thinking as you of you as a great politician. And I forget you're a great preacher and a great
thank
theologian.
Thank you. It's good to say that. Thanks. Thank you.
You get a kiss.
Thank you.
I was just
I like
so
that.